Armed with their ceremonial shovels, Los Altos Mayor Lou Becker and Los Altos Hills Mayor Bob Johnson signaled the beginning of the building process of the new History Education Center in July of this year, 1999, at a community groundbreaking. Since that time, work is well underway at the site as the Conrado Construction Company shapes the underpinnings of the new building. This artist's rendering of the new education center of the History House Association is fast becoming a reality. This barn-like building will complete the rural setting of the History Center. It will be the first museum ever built in Los Altos and will house a permanent exhibit that will present the changes in land use over time by telling the story of the land and the people who inhabited it. That is the land what we know now as Los Altos and Los Altos Hills. Hello, I'm Nan Geschke, your host of the Los Altos History Show. Joining us tonight are Madelyn Crawford, who's the director of the History House Museum, and Bob Grimm, who is overseeing the construction of the new education center now being built on the Civic Center campus. Welcome, Madelyn and Bob.
Thank you. It's really wonderful to have you here tonight.
Nice to be here.
We're glad to be here.
We've worked together now for quite a long time, but it's going to be exciting to be able to share, you know, what this new education center is going to bring to Los Altos.
Definitely.
So, Madelyn, before we actually get into sort of the details of the building, how did this idea get started in Los Altos in the first place?
In December of 1977, the museum opened with the Changing Exhibit Program. And then later, in the early 90s, the idea of the museum changed and shifted to a 1930 to 1940 focus. And the house was redone in a really excellent way. But in creating that focus story, the wider story of Los Altos had to be stepped away from.
I see.
I think at that point, the association began to dream and to be ambitious about how they could create another building that would allow them to have a lot more flexibility and tell different parts of the historical story and provide space for classes and lectures and things like that.
So that's how it got started, just
that's
through,
my understanding.
Through the association members themselves.
The can-do, ambitious attitude of people in Los Altos, people like Marion and Bob and yourself and other community leaders.
Who had, you know, had some kind
had
of a vision,
for what
might really sort of round out the campus on the
yes.
Civic Center campus.
Yes.
That's interesting. Now, Bob, I know that the center is being built with private funds, and it's actually going to be donated to the city after its completion. How was the money raised? I know you've been with the project from the beginning. You know, how do we get to the point where we're actually building a building now?
Well, it's been a while. It actually started with the History House Association having fundraisers back in the 1980s, and they have two major ones every year, the Crab Feed, which is held at the beginning of the year, and then they have an antique fair, which is in the summer, and they started putting away that money as a nest egg for creating this idea of having another building on the site there. And this went on for a number of years, and they accumulated enough that they decided to try it out on other people. And they got some leadership gifts from people in the community to start it off. And this funded getting an architect involved, and we were very fortunate to get Goody Steinberg as our architect. who is very well respected in our area. He lived in Los Altos Hills for many years with his wife Jerry, and also he designed the Chamber of Commerce building and other buildings around Los Altos, so very well known, and we were fortunate to get him. And he made some sketches of what the building could be. We wanted something that looked like a barn, but yet was very much like a very nice museum inside. And he rose to the challenge on this. And we got something that we finally liked. And then we decided to launch a community campaign. And Jenny Lear was asked to head the fundraising for all of this. And so we've had hundreds of people that have contributed to this campaign. And as you said, the total cost of the building and all the exhibits that are going in are being raised by private funds. It's being built on part of the Civic Center, so that is city property. And then when the building is completed, it will be given to the city from the donations. And to date, we've raised about $2.3 million.
Oh, that's wonderful.
We still need some more, but this is going to be a first-class operation, and it's a community-wide project.
Yeah, I think that's important to kind of stress here too, is that, you know, the whole community was actually was asked to become involved in some way, and a lot of people have responded to that challenge, and which is really heartwarming to us who've been in it from ground zero, I guess. But, you know, I think it's also a testimonial to how much this museum is really wanted in this community.
Yeah.
Well, it'll both be a serious project and also one which I think people will take a lot of pride in. And so that when people have visitors that come to town, it'll be a nice place to take them to show something about the background of the community.
So, Bob, can you tell us a little bit about the process, about how you how we actually got started in engaging, you know, ideas about space planning and so forth and so on?
Well, you start off with a wish list of all the things that you wanted, and some of the givens that we wanted were exhibit space, and we wanted a place for permanent exhibits that told sort of the history of the Los Altos and Los Altos Hills community area. And then we wanted an area where you could have changing exhibits that would change from time to time. That would also be doubling as a place where you could have events, like you could have lectures and talks, or you could have parties there or something of this kind. And it was felt that there ought to be sort of an indoor-outdoor operation to this. And you'd need a little small kitchen so that a caterer could work there, and you'd have this. And then an important area is the archives, because we have a lot of archives of the history of the community and issues of the newspapers going back to 1900 up to the present time, plus maps, photographs, aerial photographs, paintings, and everything else that describes this. We wanted a fireproof vault to put all that in. Plus, we wanted to have a place that the community, members of the community, could come in and do research on their homes or their street or their area, things like this.
And it's also a venue probably for entertaining as
you
well.
You bet.
Yes.
Yeah, and you know, you might want to have a wedding there or a party of some sort or something like that.
So again, there's going to be two exhibit rooms.
Yes.
One temporary and one permanent.
Yep.
And there's going to be a gift shop and a kitchen. And there's going to be an archive and office area.
Yeah.
And what have I forgotten?
A storage vault.
And a storage vault, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And an outdoor space, which is part of the museum as well, a garden and outdoor setting.
And so that's all going to be integrated too, I believe, you know, with the plans for the Civic Center development in terms of parking and all of that.
Right.
You might want
the building is going to be on three levels. There'll be a ground floor, then an upper floor for the permanent exhibits, and then all of the offices and the archives will be down in the basement.
You might want to mention the farmer's workshop on the
outside
exhibits.
Oh, that's a very important part of our exhibit.
Good barns have a shed on the end to keep their farm equipment. Well, keep their junk and keep their farm equipment out of the weather and things like this. And so we're going to have a lean-to shed on one end of the barn.
Oh, that's really going to be fun.
And in there is going to be a tractor, an orchard tractor, a caterpillar-type tractor, and a sprayer that was actually used in a local orchard here. And those have already been refurbished, donated and refurbished, and are waiting in storage. And we have a farmer's workbench that's going to go at the end, where a farmer's tools will be on display there, and all the types of things that he would use to maintain the equipment that he uses on his farm. So it's going to be a fun place.
It sounds like it's going to be a tremendous addition to Los Altos to have a kind of facility like this, and to really sort of spotlight, you know, the history of what has gone on here, and you know, really sort of inform people, because a lot of people are constantly moving into the area, and they need to be educated about, you know, the roots of this community.
So, and how they can participate in it.
And how they can participate in it.
Right? And I think that something like this will give pride in the community, and my feeling is that if people are proud of their community, they'll also take care of it.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, I know that we did at one time have an exhibit that told some of the story of Los Altos.
Right.
Now, what's been the process in actually developing the permanent exhibit for this for the education center?
Well, it's been a community-based process. Nan has been chairing the program and interpretive committee, and I'm sorry, but you deserve credit.
Along with a lot of other people.
And there are about 14 people that have been working for the last 2.5 years on that particular project, including an educator from the elementary school system, a retired administrator, and a high school teacher. So we have a lot of professional expertise in the committee. They've been working on developing a story of land use and land management by the different people who inhabited the area. So it starts out with the Ohlone style of land stewardship, goes into the agricultural period, the orchard history, begins to work its way into the incorporation of the city, and then goes on to the Silicon Harvest and the idea of a hometown community of today. So there's an interesting story that goes chronologically through time. There's a special signature exhibit in the permanent exhibit, which is a train history exhibit. And the train was very central to the development of Los Altos. It's a kind of classic railroad town in California. And I think I'll turn to Bob and have him talk a little bit more about
that,
the train component.
You were quite instrumental, Bob, in actually getting Bob Brown and Fred Vertel, who also have been guests on our show, by the way, you know, who are delightful people. You know, tell us about how you engage them and what you know about the train exhibit so far.
Well, when we think about the history of Los Altos, you got to think about trains, because they played such an important role in all this. And so I knew a fellow at Glenn McGee that lives here that was a train buff. In fact, if you call his phone and you get the answering machine, you hear train sounds and all that. And so
that's a train buff.
Yeah, that's a train buff. So I called up Glenn and said, we're doing a new museum here, and we think we ought to include something about trains. Do you have a number of other train friends that maybe would like to have lunch and kick around ideas about what we might do? And so he invited some people, and we had lunch down at Max Tea Room and kicked it around. And one of the people at that lunch was Fred Vertel. And Fred then subsequently invited us over to his house, where he and his son Tom live. And they have trains everywhere.
Oh, I know. I've been there. It's just amazing. I know. It's marvelous.
In the bedrooms, the bathrooms, the kitchen. Every room in the place.
And up and down the walls.
Yeah, in the attic and all that, they have hundreds of trains. And these are precise model trains. They're not toy trains. They're real serious model maker type trains. Anyhow, out of that, he introduced us to Bob Brown, who is also a Los Altos resident. And Bob is a precision model maker. And he also publishes magazine on railroads as his vocation. So they came up with a proposal that they would make the exhibit for us. And then we kicked around themes, and what it's going to end up being is a diorama about 25 feet long, which is across the whole size of the room, side of the room, that is going to be downtown Los Altos in the early 1930s. And it's looking at it, First Street from across the railroad tracks from University Avenue. And you're gonna see all the buildings, and Bob Brown is building all those buildings, and he's already completed about a half a dozen of them, working from old photographs of the 1930s.
Right, and so, using the oral histories to create the vignettes and the scenes.
Yeah.
It sounds wonderful.
And it's going to be an operating railroad, and what a lot of people don't realize is that there were two railroads that went through here. One was the regular steam train, the Southern Pacific, and then there was also the Peninsular Electric Railroad. And so both tracks will be going through.
So both tracks will be going through.
And they will both be operating, and there will be sounds from the engines and from that and from the stations, and also there'll be animation.
So it's going to be a real attraction for kids of all ages, right?
Yep. Including young ones.
Yes. I know, I can just see it now. I mean, it's that everyone's going to make a beeline for that exhibit, at least for the first time around.
Right. Yeah. It'll be a great show.
Yeah. I think it'll be a repeat.
Right. Yeah.
You know, people,
and there's going to be enough things in it that you won't get it all the first time.
Oh, yeah. Right. So. Yeah. Well, you know, in terms of, you know, let's just go back a little bit in terms of, you know, developing this idea of land use. Now, I know there were people on the committee who were who were instrumental, and also we've hired a professional design firm as well.
The scholarly leadership on the land use theme has been provided all along by Yvonne Jacobson, who's a really noted historian in our county, and also by Carol Teft, the recently retired librarian for the community. About spring of 98, the committee was interviewing seven exhibit design firms and settled on the Sibbett Group, which is a San Francisco-based firm, and we're working alongside with them and feeling really pleased with the relationship. So we feel certain that we're going to have the scholarly element, the authenticity, but also the fun and the good design all put together.
You know, as part of that, that team that actually chose the Sibbett Group, I think it was interesting to put out that request for proposal and get the input that we did get. We were able to get seven or eight design firms who were actually interested in doing the project.
With a lot of different approaches.
And, yes. I thought that was kind of interesting, too. Yeah. And we chose the Sibbett Group because they had a very sort of creative flair about their approach.
Mm-hmm. Innovative.
They also got, I know they got the community involved.
Right, there were focus groups, including ones that had people who had never been involved in the project and had a lot of the conventional history. There are key outline points along the history that everybody shares, whether they're very involved in it or very distant, and that was really an interesting process.
You know, and one thing that was done before that was to visit a number of other museums. We must have visited about 15 other
museums. That took a lot of our time, didn't it?
Right, but it allowed us to look at what things that we thought that they did well and what things that they didn't do well in each one of them with copious notes so that you could really do that. And it forces you, when you're doing this, to really look at it as a museum and not just as an experience for yourself.
Yeah.
And I think that was very beneficial to do that prior to interviewing.
And that was also helpful for the exhibit designers and actually giving them some feedback about what we thought was engaging.
What to leave out.
And what's
important for visitors and what's not.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of the programming for the museum, you know, what's been the process in all of that? I know that there are some ongoing programs.
There are two famous local ongoing programs, the Margaret Thompson Essay Contest and the third grade local history tour program. And we will be continuing and building on those, but we had a Blue Ribbon Education Task Force that met to brainstorm ideas for audiences of all ages. So we're hoping to move over the next 2 years into a really full service, educationally oriented museum with family programs, lectures for adults, everything from bibliographies to maybe book discussion groups, so just a wide range of services.
And I know I attended one of the new Music and Memories afternoons a couple of weeks ago, and I thought it would be fun for our viewers to see just a small clip of that that afternoon, because it was really a fun event and something that I, you know, other kinds of programs will come through, I know, through a lot of people's creativity. So let's roll that clip now.
Okay.
It's someone like you, a pal good and true. I'd like to leave it all behind and go and find some place that's known to God alone. Just a spot to call our own.
That was really a fun event, and their voices were so beautiful. So what you shared today, both you and Madelyn, Bob, have been, it's been so exciting. I mean, the news that this building, the very first museum in Los Altos, is actually being built is, I think, exciting news for the town. So, Bob, when can we expect this building?
Well, it's under construction right now. The basement walls are being poured this week, and the total construction of the building should be finished next summer, and then it'll take us a few months to move the exhibits in. So about this time, October of the year 2000 should be about the time that we open to the public.
So about a year from now.
About a year from now.
Isn't that exciting?
It is. Yep.
And I know that there are some volunteer opportunities.
Definitely.
Madelyn, what are some of the pressing ones?
Most immediate is that we need more docents. We're expanding the hours as a readiness for the Education Center, and we have a wide variety of opportunities, and the most important incentive for people is that we have a really good crew of interesting people to work with. So there's a wonderful social benefit to being involved in History House.
So I think that we're going to put that phone number of the History House Museum up on the screen right now. And so if people are interested in volunteering, whether it be for a docent job or any other job that they...
Or behind the scenes or the gardening committee, there's just a huge range.
They should call that and ask for you or maybe some of the other volunteers that might be in History House at that time.
I can refer people. They, you know, they can start with me.
Right. Well, it's just been delightful to have you two tonight. Talking about our most favorite subject at the moment, the History House Education Center. It's dear to all of our hearts anyway. And I think it's going to be a very prized landmark in Los Altos. So thanks.
It's a really exciting project.
It is. Thanks for joining us tonight. And
thank you
viewers for watching the Los Altos History Show. We'll see you next time.